everyone! Welcome back to integralcalc.com. Today we're going to be doing a partial fractions problem, and in this particular problem we've got the function x squared divided by the quantity x plus 2 cubed, and we're going to be taking the integral of that. In order to do so, we need to use partial fractions. The interesting thing about this problem is that we have linear repeated factors. So remember, when you're dealing with a partial fractions problem, the first thing you need to decide is whether or not you're dealing with linear factors or quadratic factors, and in either case, whether or not you're dealing with distinct factors or repeated factors. In this case, in our denominator, we don't have any x squared, x cubed, x to the fourth terms, anything like that. We just have an x to the first power right here. So that means that we're dealing with a linear factor. And because it's cubed, right, because we have x plus 2 times x plus 2 times x plus 2, that linear factor is repeated. So we've got a linear repeated factor. We're going to treat that in a very specific way as opposed to distinct linear factors or quadratic, distinct quadratic or repeated quadratic factors. So just remember that for partial fractions, what we're going to do is we're going to take our function and we're going to put it over here on the left-hand side of a new equation that we're going to create exactly as it is. On the right-hand side, we're going to go ahead and perform the partial fractions decomposition. And the way that we're going to do that with a linear repeated factor is we're going to make sure that we include every factor, including its lesser degree. So we're going to include x plus 2 cubed, but we're also going to include all lesser factors. So we're also going to include x plus 2 squared and x plus 2 to the first power, which will just be x plus 2. We don't need the parentheses. So when we have linear repeated factors, we have to include the factor itself, right? X plus 2 cubed and each of the lesser degree factors. So in this case, because it's cubed, we have to include x plus 2 squared and x plus 2 to the first power. If we had x plus 2 to the fourth power, we'd have to include that as well as all of these lesser factors. And this is, again, something that we only do when we have a repeated factor. So this is our partial fractions decomposition. Now we need to go ahead and multiply both sides of our equation by the denominator from the left-hand side. So essentially, right, we're going to multiply both sides by this. So we're going to take the entire equation and we're going to multiply by x plus 2 to the third power. So of course on the left-hand side, that's going to cancel the denominator and we'll just be left with x squared. When we multiply it by this a over x, the quantity x plus 2 cubed, it will also cancel the denominator and we'll just be left with a. When we multiply it by the term where the numerator is b, the denominator will cancel and we'll just be left with x plus 2 to the first power in the numerator. And when we multiply it by the last term, c over x plus 2, we'll be left with x plus 2 squared in the numerator. So now we've gotten rid of all of our fractions, and we need to go ahead and multiply out the right-hand side of the function. So a plus bx plus 2b plus 2b, and then we'll go ahead and multiply out this x plus 2 squared. So we'll get x squared plus 4x plus 4 when we FOIL that out. And now we're going to distribute that c. So we'll end up with a plus bx plus 2b plus cx squared plus 4cx plus 4c. Now that we multiplied everything out, we need to go ahead and group like terms together. So we're going to group all of our x squared terms together, all of our x terms together, and then all of our constant terms together. And by constants, we're talking about terms that don't involve the x variable. So the only term involving x squared is this cx squared. So I'll go ahead and put the c in parentheses to illustrate a point that we're going to make next. So we've got cx squared, and I'll go ahead and cancel these out as we go. Then for x to the first power, we've got bx and 4cx. So we'll say b plus 4c times x, right? So I took bx plus 4cx and I divided the x out of that term, so I have b plus 4c times x. Then we're left with just constants. So we've got plus a plus 2b plus 4c, and these are all constants. So now we can go ahead and say we've counted for the 4c, the 2b, and the a. The reason we're grouping terms like this is because what we're going to do is we're going to equate coefficients on the left and right hand side of the equation. So notice here that on the left hand side, the coefficient on x squared is 1, right? It's 1x squared. Well, what we can do is we can go ahead and identify that the coefficient on the x squared term is 1 on the left hand side. On the right hand side, it's c, which means that c must be equal to 1. We also know on the left-hand side, right, the left-hand side essentially is x squared, right, 1x squared, which we already said, but then it's plus 0x plus 0 if we were going to go ahead and complete that polynomial. So what we know is that, in this case, b plus 4c is equal to 0, and we know that a plus 2b plus 4c is also equal to 0. So we can go ahead and write those equations out. So b plus 4c equals 0, and a plus 2b plus 4c equals 0. Now we can use the method of simultaneous equations that we learned from algebra to solve for a, b, and c. We already know that c is equal to 1. So let's go ahead and plug that into the second equation, because as you can see, we'll be able to solve for b. So we'll get b plus 4 equals 0, right? 4 times 1 is just 4. When we subtract 4 from both sides, we get b equals negative 4. So now we've solved for b. We can plug b and c into our third equation to find a. So we'll have a plus 2b. So we need 2 times negative 4, which is a negative 8. And then plus 4c. So 4 times 1, since c is equal to 1, gives us 4. So we've got plus 4 equals 0. And when we solve this, we will get a minus 4 equals 0. We'll add 4 to both sides, and we'll get a equals positive 4. So now we've solved for all three variables, and we can go ahead and plug these back into our partial fractions decomposition up here, and we'll integrate that. So we'll take the integral, instead of taking the integral of our original function now, we'll be taking the integral of 4, right? We're going to plug in 4 for a. So 4 divided by x plus 2 cubed. Then we'll plug in for b, which is negative 4, so we'll get minus 4 over x plus 2 squared. And then for c, we've got 1, so we'll have plus 1 over x plus 2 dx. And with partial fractions decompositions, now that we have three discrete fractions, we can go ahead and break those apart into their separate integrals, which will make this a little bit easier for us to solve. I'm also going to go ahead and bring the 4 out in front of the integral as a coefficient. So what we'll end up with is 4 times the integral of 1 over x plus 2 to the third. What I'm going to do, remember this rule from algebra that when you have 1 over x to the n, or really any constant over x to the n, that's the same thing as x to the negative n. What this tells me is that when I have x plus 2 to the third in the denominator here, I can move it to the numerator as long as I call it the quantity x plus 2 to the negative 3. So I've got 4 times x plus 2 to the negative 3. I'll write down the dx to signify the end of that integral, and then I'm going to move on to my second integral. So I'll say minus 4 times the integral of x plus 2 to the negative 2 dx plus the integral of, and we'll go ahead and leave this as it is because that's easy to find the integral when we leave that in the denominator. So now we're going to go ahead and integrate. So here we'll get 4 times, remember we're adding 1 to the exponent, right? So plus 1 gives us a negative 2, and then we divide by our new exponent. So I'm going to do 1 over negative 2, x plus 2 to the negative 2, and according to chain rule, we'd have to divide by the derivative of the inside. Well, the derivative of x plus 2 is just 1, so I'm essentially just dividing by 1, that's all I need to do. So that's going to be the integral of my first, the integral of my first integral here. Then I'll have minus 4 times, again, adding 1 is going to be negative 1 here in the exponent. So I've got 1 over negative 1 times x plus 2 to the negative 1. And then finally, 1 over x plus 2 is just the natural log of x plus 2. And of course, I have to add c to account for my constant of integration. And now I'm just simplifying. So 4 divided by negative 2 gives me a negative 2. And I have times x plus 2 to the negative 2. Remember that I can move that back to the denominator and make the exponent positive. So I've got negative 2 over x plus 2 squared. Negative 4 divided by negative 1 gives me a plus 4. And again, I'm going to move my quantity x plus 2 to the negative 1 to the denominator. And that negative 1 becomes positive 1. And then I'm going to go ahead and leave this as it is. Plus ln of x plus 2 plus c. The only thing I would do here, I could leave this as my final answer, but it's probably cleanest if I simplify these first two pieces here into a common fraction. So what I'm going to do is multiply this second term here by x plus 2 over x plus 2, which will give me my common denominator over x plus 2. So what I'll get is negative 2 over x plus 2 squared plus 4 times x plus 2, and the numerator there gives me 4x plus 8. And of course, x plus 2 times x plus 2 in the denominator is x plus 2 squared. So now I can combine these, and I'll just go ahead and do that here. So 4x plus 8 minus 2 is going to be 4x plus 6 all over the quantity x plus 2 squared, and I got to bring down my natural log of x plus 2, and of course c, my constant of integration. And that's my final answer. So 4x plus 6 over the quantity x plus 2 squared plus the natural log of x plus 2 plus c is the integral of our original function up here, x squared over the quantity x plus 2 cubed. So that's it. I hope this video helps you guys, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!